Hi, I'm Garland Jeffries, and thank you very much for listening to Music News.
Garland Jeffries, it's great to see you. Feeling good today?
Yeah, I feel good. I'm sort of jet lagged, but you know.
Yeah, flew in yesterday?
Yeah, flew in yesterday, New York to London, you know.
Yeah. I've been doing a set of dates over here. Is London a place that you know quite well?
Yes, I've come over the years many times, you know. And recently, my daughter, she is a student now, and she spent a semester abroad in London, and that was a great experience for her, you know, on her own in the big city, young girl. Having a great time, and she's traveled to Italy herself and all that, and really, I'm so proud of her, and a fantastic kid, very smart kid.
Yeah. London's a great hub to travel to a lot of places, to be honest.
Yeah.
Great European destinations. But anyway, your album, 14 Steps to Harlem, is released on April the 28th. Great title. What does it signify, and what can we expect?
14 Steps to Harlem, it's a powerful story, you know. It's my father was born in Harlem, he lived in Harlem, and then he moved down to Brooklyn and lived with my mom and other parts of my family in a house. We had a nice house, and he then wound up having to go back to Harlem because he found a job up in Harlem, you know, which is quite a distance, you know, you know, and to travel every day back and forth. And that's that in right there, essence of him. He was quite a guy, you know, because he didn't have an education, came from a poor background, but he always was, he was giving to the family, you know. He built a family. He was really quite fantastic in that way. Very strict guy. A little too strict for me, really. But he came from a place where he was treated that way from his family. And we found a way to be if you ever hear of Jackie Robinson, baseball player.
Yeah, it sounds familiar.
Yeah, he broke the color line years ago in baseball. And my father says that my father could play, but the color line wasn't broken, so he couldn't play.
Yeah.
And by the time he, you know, the color line was broken, he was too old to play in the majors.
Yeah.
And these are some of the 14 Steps to Harlem. This is some of the feelings and the what makes it meaningful to me, you know. And I look at my father today, you know, and I realize he did everything he could to help me and my brother. And anytime I think about it, you know, it brings a tear to my eye, you know, your feelings, you know.
Yeah.
Because the man was, one day he said to me, you're going to be going to Syracuse University. So really, he says, yeah, you've been accepted, and you'll go there, and it should be good for you, you know. And I did, and I excelled in the school, and I met Lou Reed there.
Yes.
And Lou and I became best friends for our whole life. We were friends till the day before he died, or the week before he died. Now, of course, I'm very tight with and close with both my wife and I, close with Laurie Anderson. lovely, lovely person. You probably know a little bit about her.
Yeah, yeah.
She's a fantastic person, you know. So she's playing on the new album as well.
Yeah,
no, you got. Yeah. And let me see. We're going to do a big show in New York soon, and she'll be performing her violin on my song, Luna Park Love Theme.
Yes, lovely song.
Yeah.
And I mean, the album was crowdfunded as well, along with an all-encompassing documentary. How did you, why was the time right for that sort of approach?
Well, you know, it's like I have a story to tell.
Yeah.
You know, and the idea is to, you know, we're raising the money for it now. We have a lot of support around it, and we just have to build that up to the point where we can. My wife will be, putting that,
yes,
directing
yes.
that, and my wife.
Has it started? I mean, it must have been. Is it mostly recorded?
The process of funding takes some time.
Yeah, well, 163% this morning.
Yeah.
It's done. So not too bad at all in that respect.
Yeah.
And, you know, are you telling, I mean, your life has been quite amazing. You've met a lot of characters, you know, Springsteen, U2, say Lou Reed, Velvet Underground.
Yeah.
What are your highlights?
I mean, in terms of the folks that I've met? And...
Yeah, musical highlights, I guess.
Well, you know, first of all, Lou and I were best buddies. And the one thing I would like to say about Lou is that he, you know, he had a reputation of being a difficult person. But he was a fantastic friend and supporter of me. All the way through the time that we were buddies all those years, like made tight. And I saw him, of course, the week that he died. But you know, he was a dear friend.
Yeah. I mean, the album recording process this time as well. How did that was it different to what you normally do?
Well, I think that every time you make a record, you know, there's something different about the. The approach, the studio you work in, the players you're working with. You know, sometimes you change producers. You're used to working with a certain person. I've worked with Sonny Rollins, you know, and what a thrill that was. You know, and he came in and played us on one of my songs. Fantastic. To work with those kind of musicians, it's a thrill and it's like an honor. And I work with Colm McRae.
Yeah.
Fantastic, you know. Colm McRae was a relative of my family, you know. So this is some of the great experiences I've had.
Are there a lot of musicians that you still like to work with?
Well, I worked with Michael Brecker. You know, Michael and I were really close friends, and he was always a big supporter and admirer of my songs. You know, so that was a thrill because I respected him a great deal. But what a we would say a mensch. He was.
Yeah.
And it was so sad that he passed away, you know, because he had an illness that was just, I thought that maybe it was a drug thing. No, he had some sort of illness that he, you know, I don't even recall what it was. And he was stricken with this and he couldn't talk.
Oh my word.
He couldn't talk. His talking was finished. And, you know, people couldn't understand it, you know. This guy was the sweetest person and always a very supportive person in my career.
Yeah. I bet, you must have met absolutely millions of people. And
yeah.
I'm sure the documentary will reveal all.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
When is it due for release? Do you have a
fixed date? Got to speak with the boss, you know. Not the boss, but my boss.
Yeah. I mean, the album itself, though, it's a real mixture of emotions and styles. You know, you're clearly at home across, you know, a whole range of styles, rock, blues, reggae, soul. Where does your musical heart sort of lie, ultimately, would you say?
Well, I'm a rock and roller, you know. That's really where it is for me, you know. I like rock and roll music. But I love different kinds of music, you know. So I have found a way over the years to incorporate all these styles, you know, on different albums. You know, you don't have every style,
yeah,
but
yeah.
You know, I like over the course of my career to become friendly with different styles of music and players and studios, producers. Like, I worked on this new album, which I'm got to tell you, I'm very proud of this new record.
It's a great listen, yeah. I really enjoyed it.
It's really wonderful, you know. I'm really happy, and everybody who's heard it so far really loves the record, so yay! I'm really happy about it.
And it's the third album in 6 years. I mean, you know, after 5 decades, and most people would be slowing down. You
That's
seem
right.
to be ramping it up.
Yeah, man.
Is it a, you know, particularly creative? Do you feel more creative now?
I guess so. You know, I'm working on new songs now.
Yeah,
I'm working on new ideas. Yeah, I'm thinking about a new album already. You know, it's I don't really have it underway, but I'm definitely as Claire, my wife, would say, you know, you're really on a roll.
Yeah, and, absolutely.
You know, and so. I'm going to enjoy it, you know. I don't know if it'll ever stop, but I'm going to enjoy it, you know, and keep, you know, satisfying myself and my fans.
Yeah. I mean, on this album, you've got a great couple of cover versions, The Beatles' Help and Velvet Underground's Waiting for the Man. What sort of significance have they got, personally, for you?
Yeah, okay. Well, with Help... It's a great little tale, great little story. I worked in a studio in New York called the Record Plant, great studio. I worked with a guy named Roy Sakala, who's not alive anymore. Great guy, and he was very what a wonderful person he was. So encouraging to me. One of the reasons why I've excelled. In my work, Roy is one of them. You know, so in my life, I've met people along the way who've lifted me up and given me something, you know, and shown me things, and I've learned from these people.
Yeah.
You know, I was a good, pretty good student, you know, and so Roy was working with John Lennon. On some of the new things he was doing post Beatles, and Roy, who was working on Roy and Lennon, became very close. You know, Lennon needed someone he could trust, and Roy was perfect because Roy was a very regular guy. He wasn't in awe of. Of course, he was somewhat in awe of Lennon, but he wasn't. He was a prankster and joker. So he was quite a prankster and so much fun, though, you know. And so one day he brings Lennon and Yoko into the studio to meet me. Because Roy was a dear pal, he became a dear friend. So he introduced me to Lennon, and I said, "Wah, blah, 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 blah." You know, and I talked with him, and it was very, very sweet, and very funny, always laughing, always making jokes and pranks.
Yeah.
You know, and Roy was, I think Lennon learned some of those tricks from Roy because he was quite a prankster himself. And one day I received, around this time, I received a letter from John Lennon saying that was really great to meet you. We'll see each other another time, you know, and it was very regular. No airs, no, how would you say, snootiness.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Just a prankster and funny guy, you know, very, likes to have fun, you know, and learned a lot from that experience, you know, and so that was really a big deal for me, you know. So I've had mentors along the way that have been very supportive, you know, one way or another.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah. So. No, amazing. And I mean, they come across particularly well on the album as well. I think as a piece of music, as a document, fantastic. You know?
Yeah, thank you.
I mean, far, you know, obviously you're an experienced professional to the to the most professional end. But do you still feel that you're learning?
Of course. Of course, yes. Here's a giant right here. Here's a couple of giants. A couple of giants just walked in. Hey fellas, you standing? Still standing?
Oh no.
Hello. Yeah, I mean, so you played with many of the greats, as they say. But who would you play with, like to sort of perform with these days from the modern crowd, the modern sort of songwriters, would you say?
Let me see. Yeah. Nobody. No, let me think for a second. No. I guess these days I'm very involved with my own people I work with, the musicians I play with, my band members, so I feel like I'm steeped in that kind of thing, you know.
Yeah.
And I'm always open to working with different people, you know. If there's an opportunity that seems right, you know, like the Sonny Rollins experience was just so special, you know.
What about musical ambitions? Do you still feel that you've got a lot, something left to prove or something left to achieve? What sort of drives you forward?
Well, I like music, you know. I mean, new ideas come up and new styles come into mind, you know. Like I hear something that someone's doing. Here's somebody playing something that's very interesting, a jazz player often, you know. I have a friend, his name is James Maddock, fantastic artist as far as he was the co-producer on my new album. Great buddy. He's really, really kind of guy that he taught me a lot of things, you know. So I try to stay open to what people have to offer, you know, and enjoy the experience, you know.
Yeah,
usually friendships develop out of it.
Yeah. I mean, if you had to sum up your career, how would you sum it up?
Horrible. No, I mean, you know, I would say that it's been a career that I've been fortunate to have. You know, I started out as a young kid. I used to sing in front of the class in kindergarten, first grade. And at the time, Frankie Lyman was hot, you know.
Yeah.
And I wanted to be like Frankie Lyman. One of the songs he sang was "I'm Not a Know-It-All." I'm not a know-it-all. Don't know why the treetops fall. Don't know what's beyond the blue. I only know that I love you. You know, this sort of stuff was what I heard, but this was the kind of foundation that really entered into me, you know. And when I met Lou, he loved Frankie Lyman, and we had this comradeship right out of that kind of music, doo-wop and those kind of sounds.
Yeah. Hey, and I mean, your songwriting process then, has it changed The songwriting process for you, has it changed along the years or still?
Yeah, it does.
Fundamentally the same.
It does. Fundamentally, it's the same. You know, an idea comes up.
Yeah.
And it turns into a something, a few lines or something, you know. And I go from there, you know. And I'm influenced by others, you know, other people's styles. You know, I'm a thief, so I'll rob an idea, and it somehow is part of my becomes part of what I'm doing. And I think a lot of songwriters, but there's no original is a questionable
word. You know, everybody's influenced by somebody else at some point. It has to be. That's how you learn, I guess. How the art evolves.
Yeah.
So. I mean, away from music, what do you like getting up to?
Drugs. That's it.
Always the best choice.
Well, I, you see my wife over here, Claire. Mm. She's my love.
Like
you have a sweet girl.
Absolutely.
You know, and that's you know, that's a wonderful thing. And we have a fantastic daughter who's a musician also.
Yeah,
and she plays piano, sings, and quite a talent, very, very talented. Savannah Ray.
Yeah.
Savannah Ray Jeffries.
We will look out for her. But thanks a lot for your time, by the way. It's been an absolute pleasure.
Yeah.
For somebody that's, you know, just getting into Garland Jeffries at this stage, what sort of three songs would you say from across your career, your repertoire? So check these three songs out. They really sum me up as an artist.
Oh, wow. There's so many songs.
Yeah,
you know?
There's a lot to choose.
Let me think of three quickies. The Contortionist. That's an interesting song. Wild in the Streets, which is a song I'm known for.
Yeah.
Let me see, I wrote Come Together, the Beatles song. I wrote that one.
That would be good. Well, listen, thanks a lot for your time. It's been a pleasure. Yeah. Anything else you'd like to say to Music News Watchers?
Well, it's good to be in the UK. I love it here. Oh, shit. The boss has given me a note here. I love it here. And I really... every time I come, I seem to enjoy it more, you know.
Yeah, good.
And I feel like I'm received more in a better way over the years. People have gotten to know me.
That's the way.
And I like going, you know, all of the UK that I'm visiting, Poole, all these different towns, really nice people that I've met, you know. And you know, you people aren't that bad. You know?
Thank you very much.
That's it.
Fantastic. I'm looking forward to hearing you sing now.
Yeah.
Thanks a lot for your time.
Great.